How you guys doing tonight? Welcome to PIYC. It's going to be a good night tonight. I'm glad you showed up. Glad you took the time to get out here. And I'm glad you're not sitting at home watching like Ellen or something like that. Open up your Bibles to James 5. It's going to be a good night. And I don't mean to pay you guys off. But, it's been a good year for the ministry. Actually, I stole this from my wife's purse. But I want to hear your hidden talent. I want you to run up here right now and do something that nobody knows that you can do, and it doesn't seem like you could do it. A hidden talent. I want to say for a dollar. You know what I'm saying? Okay, fine. $2. My mind is blown. $2. Come on, I want to hear your hidden talent. Kirsten, she's a beast in that. Come here, get up here. Come on. Hidden talent. Dude, okay. And you guys are going to vote on this. So they're up. Their fate's in your hands. You want these $2, I know. I mean, retirement fund is growing. All right, show me. Don't hit me. Oh, what? Whoa. Oh, all right, that's pretty rad. Okay, somebody else? No, somebody else is good. That's pretty rad, but there might be a better one. Come on. What do you got? Hidden talent. Let's go. Get up here. We don't have any hidden talents? That's not head talent. Hidden talent. All right, while we wait for that, go to James 5. Get started. Romeo can blow milk out his ear? I'm like, that's awesome if you get milk out your ear, man. It's pretty. Deck of cards, we have one. All right, John, get up here. Get up here, John. Hidden talent. We got talented young people here at PIYC. This is going to be called PIYC's Got Talent. We're going to get Simon out here. What you got?
I need a volunteer.
You need a volunteer? Tan raises his hands fast. Get up here. He's gonna do some magic. He's got game. This might be awesome. What? What? Was that his card? Okay. Kirsten, get up here. All right, that's actually a good idea. Here you go. Dollar for you. Give him a hand. Hidden talents. That was awesome. I don't know, my mind is blown. We got David Copperfield sitting in our service. What up, David? James 5, verse 19, go with me there. Hope you're taking notes. Hope you're engaged with us. Hope you're believing God with me, that God gives you something that sustains you. The Bible says that his word is a light unto our path and a lamp unto our feet. It sustains us, helps us, gives us health in our bodies, strength in our marrow. In our marrow is the stuff that powers up your bones, I believe. I don't really not really know what marrow is, but it's inside your bones. I do know that. And it sustains us. And the word is alive, sharper than any two-edged sword, and it divides. It helps you have a moral compass. And so that's why we always start with Scripture. Have you guys ever noticed that? It's kind of important, because I've heard a preacher once say that if you don't start with the Word of God, if you can at least start with the Bible, at least the first 10 minutes of your message is good. And so that's why I start with the Bible. Okay? James 5:19 says, "My dear friends, if you know people who have wandered off from God's truth, don't write them off. Go after them and get them back, and you will have rescued precious lives from destruction and prevented an epidemic of wandering away from God." I'm going to read that again because I want you to let that sink in. My dear friends, who's he talking to? Who's James talking to? The church, right? Us. He says, "Hey, you guys, Nikolai, Nirvan, John, listen up. If you know people who have wandered from God's truth," do you guys know anybody who has wandered from God's truth? Yeah, it says, hey, if you know these people, don't write them off. Influence them, go after them, and get them back. And by doing so, you will have rescued precious lives from destruction. One version says from hell. You need to understand that you can fall away from God like that. Say, hey, get them back, and you'll prevent an epidemic of wandering away from God. You can influence that way. Go with me to Galatians 6:1. Galatians 6:1. In the NLT says, Dear brothers and sisters, if another believer is overcome by some sin, you who are godly, that's us, hopefully, right, should gently and humbly help that person back onto the right path. How many of you guys have ever seen somebody struggling and instead of helping them, you kind of almost judge them? You're like, shh, chumps, you should know better. Idiot, you're not a real Christian. And the Bible is giving us some pretty clear instructions of what we do, what we should be doing when we see people struggling. We should gently and humbly help that person back on the right path. And we should also be careful that we don't fall into the same temptation ourselves. We should share each other's burdens. And in this way, obey the law of Christ. And if you think you're too important to help someone, you're only fooling yourself. You are not that important. I love that. Title of today's message is, We Are Not Alone. We are not alone. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. And Lord, help me preach, help the students listen. And Father, I pray by the end of the day, we would all be challenged to influence our worlds, not walk alone, not pretend like we're the Lone Ranger, but we would be effective in our communities. We thank you for it. Everybody said, amen. How many of you guys have ever seen like a Rambo movie? You guys like Rambo? How many of you guys have ever seen like any action movie where the guy like has endless bullets? And it's like ridiculous now. I'm actually falling asleep. I fell asleep at movies all the time now. We watched a Tom Cruise movie. What's it called? Something. Yes, we watched that. It was good. I started falling asleep in the end of it. I'm like old now. I don't know. It's weird. And like literally I'm like, oh, movie's over. That was good. How was it, babe? What happened? I do that a lot. In the movie theater too. That's even the worst. It's like, dude, it's one thing to fall asleep on your couch. It's another thing like to be snoring in the movie theater. But I find myself in any action movie finding myself like be like, dude, that is so not real. Like, could you just at least pretend to make it real? One guy is not that good of a shot. Not that, you know, he doesn't have that many rounds. I actually am the guy who counts the rounds. I'm like, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. It's like, okay, he's out now and he's still shooting. So they never reload and things like that. Anyway, the Lone Ranger guy in Hollywood makes it, but the Lone Ranger in life will not. And I've just been kind of thinking about this. And there was one good movie. It was like a SEAL movie. And it showed, one thing I loved about it was like really bad actors. And what was the name of that movie? It was really bad. But it showed the brute strength of like the SEAL teams and how they don't go in with one guy. They send in two teams of four or six, and then they're backed up with a bunch of teams as well. And then when they come in with guns blazing, and it's like they kill everything. It's awesome. And it showed like the power. It showed really how teammates work and how being alone is not really practical. Rambo does it, but nobody else does, and nobody else can. And I wanted to, we've been talking about influence, and I really want you guys to realize that you're not alone. One, people are watching you. People are examining your life. If the second, John, you say you're a Christian, they're automatically eyes on you. Actually, the truth of it, even if you're not a Christian, they're already eyes on you. And they're wondering what moves you're going to make. They're wondering how you're going to respond in a situation. And if we're not careful, you can get this lone ranger mentality where you just, I'm going to do my thing. You do your thing. Hate is going to hate. You know, I'll just do my thing. You do your thing. Don't judge. And I think that's an ugly attitude because you can almost do life without people. I just started cycling recently. I know, I'm looking buff. Yes, you just agree with me. Jeez, thank you. I got like biker legs, right? I'm kind of a slow biker because I'm fat still, but I'm working on it, okay? I'm losing weight. I'm trying to eat better. If I could just stop the Dutch Brothers. But anyway, I started biking, and I took on a century bike ride. It was my first one. I did 104 miles, pat myself on the back. But one thing I learned, and I did it all come by myself because no people will get a bike and step up in this church, and so I did it by myself. There's a hint, Nirvan, Adam, nobody else. Thanks. I'm all by myself. I need friends. Anyway, so I'm doing this century, and when you're a cyclist, the best thing to do is to get into a group because once you get into a group, you can literally save 44% of your energy by drafting up and hooking up with another person. And the bigger the team you have, I was actually even going to show this, but I thought that might be too much for this analogy. I was like boring you with biking knowledge. But I realized quickly, when you're doing 100 miles, you need help. You get like at 36 miles, I've hit two walls lately, and that for some reason on that 100 mile, I was eating food real good, but something happened around 36 miles, and like I'm like, uh-oh, loopy. My arms started getting numb, and I'm like, I need some water. Get some water. And this is all happening while you're on the road with cars, and I'm like drinking my water, and then I like try to put my water bottle back into my bike, and I dropped it. I'm like, uh-oh. And then when you're driving and you got to turn around and get your bike bottle, I knew something. I'm like, I'm not doing very well, so I popped some jelly beans. I don't know why I had jelly beans. No, they're good jelly beans. They're like not just candy jelly beans. They're like energy jelly beans. But I felt better after that. But I found quickly that I was trying to like go fast like some of these. And then literally these teams, these group of guys would just whoom. And that you could hear them coming because they have this wind that follows them. And they're all in stretchy pants, and they're all matching, and they all like have a team logo. And I'm in my stretchy pants, but my stretchy pants just don't look as cool as theirs. And they just go, vroom, and they pass me. And I realized quickly that being alone is not nearly as effective as being together. And so just recently, I found some guys who like to ride with other men in stretchy pants. So we are riding. And it's so cool to ride. And I'm just learning how to draft. And I'm just, you know, I don't really know. I've told these guys, I said, dude, I don't know what you're doing. But I'm going to do my best. And the closer you can get to their tire, they say 1 foot away, 6 inches away. All of a sudden, it's like, this is easy. And you look down and you're going 23 miles an hour, 24 miles an hour, 26 miles an hour. And you're just like, pedal, 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 pedal. And that's all you got to do because you're taken up in this wind and this draft of people. You totally have to trust the person in front of you. And if they crash, you're probably going to crash right on top of them. It's all good. But it was the beauty of not being alone. And we've got to realize this Christian walk, you should be not alone. You should be helping people. You should be looking around and seeing who you can come and bring alongside you and draft with you. Because the drafting thing, you know what's cool, is sometimes when you're feeling weak, You just get behind the last guy, and they say to follow the Clydesdale, because the Clydesdale is going to block the most wind. I'm the Clydesdale. So you get the big guy, and you go follow him. He'll be drafting like a semi-truck for you, and you'll just be like, hey, you'll kick back, you know, cell phone, you can text. I mean, his wind just brings you. And what you do is you find somebody stronger than you, and you hook up with them. You find somebody stronger than you, and you say, dude, let's hang out. Hey, can I be accountable with you? You just being in their presence is going to help you and empower you and help you and kind of spur you on more. And so the moment you feel weak, you just drop back and hang out with them and hook up with them, because you will be more effective. You won't be more effective. And it's a guarantee. All those guys who were flying by me on my century, they had help. One, they're able to draft. And then two, they're not working as hard. You don't have to strive as hard. And I'm sitting there as all I can do at 17 miles an hour. I'm like, come on. But it's actually a proven fact that once you start getting that speed versus your wind, to get up to 25 miles an hour, you actually have to double your power. That's your legs. And clearly, I don't have that double power. So it's so much better just to hook up with people. And young people, I want to challenge you today. Who are you influencing? Who are you looking around and purposely helping out and purposely you helping them out? You're saying, dude, I see that Christian. They're falling away. Listen, your school is chocked full of Christians who should be walking in a better light, who should be doing better. And what they're doing is they're out there all by themselves, like, and they're being like Fatty McGee, and they're wheezing, dropping water bottles, having a hard time, while you fly by with your crew, when all you got to do is open up your eyes. Or maybe I described you and your walk with God. You're all by yourself and you're wheezing. And you're wondering why this is so hard. You're wondering why you don't get it. You're wondering where's that love that everybody else has. Well, guess what? It's in that group. Why do you think it's so important to go to church? When the lions, we just went to the zoo on Monday. I'm just full of analogies today. When the lions went through the African park, and there was gazelles and lions. Gazelles are really little. But anyways, gazelles, they go after the weak ones. They go after the ones that are away from the herd. They go after the sickly ones, the childs, whoever doesn't keep up. Listen, who do you think the devil likes to go after? The weak ones, the ones who are all by themselves, ones who don't have a cadre or a small group to be a part of. The Bible says a man who isolates himself rages against all wise judgment. If I see you isolating yourself, I don't want to. Guess what? Guess what's going to be nipping at your heels? You got to be smart, young people. You got to be saying, man, I'm going to hook up. Man, I'm going to. And guys, I think this goes two ways. One, you should be hooking up with people stronger than you. But then two, John, you got to look around and say, okay, who can I help out? You know what's cool about drafting, I'm going to go back to drafting, is you get the stronger person, it can help a whole bunch of weak people. I was trying to get my wife and the girls to draft with me. They were scared to get close. I was like, come on, get closer. You'll notice it. And it's pretty hard when you're going 11 miles an hour to really notice the draft. But it's possible. I'm like, come on, just speed up a little bit. You'll feel it. The wind actually has to go by. But anyway, you can really go, if you guys go into your school, go into your community, go into your, and say, who's really struggling? Who's having a tough time? How can I influence them? And instead of being the lone ranger, instead of being like, you do your thing, I'll do mine, go up to people and say, hey, man, are you doing okay? Can I help you? Can I pray with you about anything? How's your parents doing? How many of you guys ever seen somebody fall away? Seen somebody fall away from God? It's pretty easy. It's pretty noticeable, isn't it? You can tell when somebody's not so hot spiritually, right? That's our job, to come alongside them. Hey, man, you want to get behind this draft? Don't say that to them. They'll be like, what? What do you mean? Did you eat too many beans last night? No, don't. That's not what I mean. My challenge is look at Ecclesiastes. We'll close with this scripture. Ecclesiastes 4, this was written by Solomon. He was very wise, and I love this. It's kind of a fun, poetic book in the Bible. Chapter 4, verse 7, it's a little, says, I observe yet another example of something meaningless under the sun. This is the case of a man who is all alone. All alone. Without a child, without a brother, yet who works hard to gain as much wealth as he can. You do your thing, I'll do mine. I'm just going to be successful. I'm going to be the man. Then what? I'm going to arrive. I'm going to climb the corporate ladder. For what? Meaningless under the sun. But then he will ask himself, who am I working for? Why am I giving up so much pleasure now? It is all so meaningless and depressing. He's going to start popping depression pills. Verse 9, two people are better than one. This is usually a marriage scripture, but we're going to use it for us. For they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other one can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. Young people, if you're out of church and you're screwing around and you're having a hard time and you're struggling and you have nobody around you to help you, that's not good. But if you're inside of a cadre, if you're inside of a church group, if you have a friend who you can call, I'm talking to Christian friends, say, hey, dude, can you pray with me? Can you help me out? I'm having a tough time. And so many times we have such a hard time saying that. I'm weak right now. I'm not feeling it. Last week, it was not this Monday, the Monday before, I rode with these guys, and these guys are fast, okay? These road bikes, they're fast. They got better bikes, and they're about 70 pounds less than me, and they're all skinny, and they're whatever. And they're fast, and they go up hills, and I can't see them when they go up hills because they pass me. Anyways, riding with these guys, and I kept up with them pretty decent, actually. And they were all impressed, and I was like, yes, I know, I'm good. I didn't tell them that I was wheezing to do it, but I was doing it. And for we were going over, we came down like kind of 84 Troutdale area, and there was this little bridge that goes over 84 onto 92nd Avenue. And it just goes up, like you know where it's at. It goes up, anyway, from Halsley to 92nd. And one of the lead guys, he says, all right, Nate, see you there, let's go. And he like kicks in gear. And all of a sudden, the same thing that happened to me around 36 miles on my Century happened again. It's actually called your glucose, I guess. Somehow it shuts your brain down, shuts everything down. Same thing. And then all of a sudden, I'm like, what in the world just happened? I couldn't barely move my legs. And there I go, 7 miles an hour. The rest of the mile home. And I get off my bike. He's like, you doing all right? He said, come on, get some food. You know, he knew that he probably looked at my glazed over face. I lost it. Listen, your walk with God is like a marathon. It's not a sprint. You'll have good days. You'll have bad days. And if you're not careful, you just hit a wall someday. You're like, dude, I'm not feeling it. And what was cool is this week I told him, like, dude, man, you lost me last week. I couldn't even verbalize that last week because I couldn't talk. But, man, something hit me. He said, yeah, I noticed that. That's why I was there. You know, that's why I got you some food. And I'm like, okay, thank you. And so it's good to be able to verbalize, hey, I'm struggling. And sometimes we can't admit that. We're like, dude, I'm having a tough time. Can you pray with me? You don't have to tell everybody every single problem. You don't have to name your problems and begin to hold your problems and pet your problems and pretend that they were part of your life. It's like, this is my depression. His name is Bob. It's like, no, don't name your depression. But if you're depressed, tell somebody. Like, dude, I'm struggling. But my hope is Jesus. Can you pray with me? Can you encourage me? Can I come alongside you and believe with me? Why? Because two is better than one. I just love that. Two is better than one. Keep going. Likewise, two people lying close can keep each other warm. That's awkward. Okay, but how can one be warm alone with the heat? Verse 12. A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. Three are even better. For a triple braided cord is not easily broken. Young people, you need each other. Your friends need you. You need to look around and find yourself influencing people. Don't be so proud that you can't say, hey, I need some help. Don't be so proud that you're saying, I'll do my thing and you do yours. I believe that some of us put this strong face on us, and you're like, your family life maybe is going through some tough stuff. You're like, yeah, I'm fine. And inside, you're not fine. Inside's like, yeah, I'm struggling a little bit. But I tell you today, that's what church is all about. Why do we come here week in, week out? Because we're not alone. The Bible says we come together and we're strengthening each other. Iron sharpens iron. Unfortunately, sometimes it turns into like a judge fest or a look good. Oh, hallelujah, brother. How are you doing? Oh, the Lord is good, brother and sisters, and the Lord God Almighty of heaven, and the radiant rays of Jesus shined on me today. It's like, awesome. That's weird. Okay, cool. I'm a little hungry. We need to be the people who's like, not, that's why you need a cadre. Who's in a cadre right now? Who goes to cadre constantly? Raise your hand. Come on. Raise your hand. All right. Who has never darkened the doors of a cadre? Be honest. Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Who is? Okay. Who hasn't been into a cadre in a long time? Okay. Listen. You're trying to be Long Ranger. If you haven't been in a cadre, if you haven't been in a group, even the church, if you've been in a youth service, you're trying to be Long Ranger. You're trying to be Rambo. And guess what? It won't work. It only works in Hollywood. You need a team. You need people that are surrounding you and encouraging you. Sometimes it's nothing more than just being there. And what's funny is by you being there, as I started writing in this group, me just being in that group, in the middle or in the back or in the front, it doesn't really matter where I'm at. I'm like getting the benefits of writing in that pace line, and I don't even realize how much your energy you're saving by being in there. And so many times you're like, dude, I told somebody just this the other day. I wish it was more complicated than pray, read your Bible, and come to church. I wish it was like, then let the prophecies happen. No, you know what? People who pray, read their Bible, and come to church and find that fellowship, they often do all right. And what happens, they just go through life and bumps happen, but they just go through life anyway. And that's what happens. You're like, you don't even know the energy that you're saving by being in the group. Don't forsake the assembling together. My challenge for us today, go out, look at your life, look at those around you. Find out who are you influencing and who are you helping. When Jesus was an ultimate example. Anytime he was around, he'd be like, hey, you see that fig tree? No one to eat our fruit from you again. And the thing died up and withered and died. And he used that analogy to say, hey, if you got faith like that, you stand on the mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea. He was always imparting, always encouraging everywhere he went. He saw a building, he says, yeah, this building, no stone's going to be left on its side or whatever. He says, this is going to be torn down. He was always using, always trying to impart. Listen, when you hang out with your friends, you should be prying. You should be like, hey, man, how you doing? It's never just like picking your nose and hanging out. You're always imparting. You're always trying to help. You're always trying to influence. You're always trying to say, hey, are you doing all right? Not that you have to go heavy, revy every time. Sometimes it's just being there. My challenge for us, go out, look. That was awkward. Go out. Who can you influence? Who can you help out? Who can you bring alongside you on your team? Young people, I expect, if you're 16, you should be an assistant to a cadre. If you're, you should be going through our track system. You know our weekend, we actually meant to talk about this. You know what our weekends are all about? You serving. Young people should come and serve. Get on cameras. Get on an usher's team. You should be finding ways to get involved in church. Why? So that you can be an influence. It's all about that. Amen. I'm kind of rambling a little bit. But let's pray.